The first speaker is the renowned personality who is well known to all of us, Dr.K.Subramanian. Please. Sir, with your permission, I'll just announce Dr. Major Parthasarathy's family have donated 1 lakh towards Major Parthasarathy's oration. So that will be established very soon. We thank the family for the kind gesture. Thank you.
Good evening, everybody. Thought provoking MRI. We need to concentrate on what is there and then tell it. At the outset, I'd like to thank IMA Kodam Rakam, the clinics and hospitals I'm associated with, and my group. Okay, this is the picture for you to see. What do you see? What will you do? It's obvious it's hydrocephalus and you have to do a shunt. But will you shunt such a patient with such a big hydrocephalus is the question. This is a 4-month-old child. Therefore, the skull is still expandable. The sutures haven't fused. So the skull can expand. The brain can be accommodated in a bigger skull. But still, you see only a thin sliver of brain. You see a large hydrocephalus. Is there any use in shunting this patient? Will you do a shunt or will you do an endoscopy? These are the things that run in our mind. So the thought process is like this. Occasionally we may think that the sliver of brain there is so little, if you do a shunt, maybe there will be a subdural hematoma, maybe there will be bleeding inside, child may die. So why should you do anything? Why not leave the child like this? These are the thought process that run through our mind. Because when we talk to the patients, attenders, we keep thinking, what are we going to tell them? The obvious question they will ask is, will the child become all right? The child is not able to lift its head, either because of the large head or because of the pressure inside. Is the child able to see properly? Obviously, here there will be a setting sun sign, which is called as, you know, the eyes don't go upward, very much because of the pressure on the brain and corpus callosum and all that. So would you do an endoscopy and open up? Because if you do an endoscopy in this child, assuming it's an aqueductal stenosis, and we do something like a communicating hydrocephalus sort of thing, is it going to get absorbed? Is the skull going to expand further? Will the skull expansion stop? What are we going to do? Now, the earlier thought process was that if you shunt this, maybe the child will go into subdural hematoma. But now we have got what is called as programmable shunt and high pressure shunt, low pressure shunt, etc. So we determine what it should be in this child and put in such a pressure shunt. Or there is a programmable shunt where you can adjust the program through the skin, where we can say so much of fluid drains into the abdominal cavity. Again, whenever you put a shunt for the child, maybe the child will go into ascites, because this much amount of fluid in a 4-month-old child, how much is it going to go in? So is it really useful? And then we always tell the patient's parents that, look, Urdhara Shantapota doesn't mean that it is there for life. Your child will grow. We will need a longer tube. We will have to revise. Some of the shunts fail up to 30%. We'll have to redo it. So will they come again for the recurring costs? Now, formerly in the general hospital setup in earlier years, many of these patients were lost to follow-up because, one, they weren't ready for the cost. Two, such programmable shunts were not there. Three, our understanding also was not that much. So some of these patients went away, we lost some of them. Some of them came back, said, yeah, no difference, their life. Child grew up, became better, etc. So whenever I have a doubt in my mind whether I should shunt or not, I always remember about the patient who I saw last about 5 years ago. This patient had been seen by my learned father when he was a chief in General Hospital long time ago and she was a child. That is a 32-year-old female. She is a practicing auditor in the city of Chennai. She is doing a good job. She has got large clientele. This is a case of arrested hydrocephalus. She has GH lapatha seat. Many years ago, as a child, her parents had taken her. And her parents refused treatment, saying that, "Naga enna panna porom? How many times to shunt? What are we going to do this time? Let her grow." So she passed the 12th standard in the first attempt, BCom in first attempt, articleship in first attempt, became a successful auditor. She is married, has two kids. This is the brain. Now, is this all the brain that we need?
True.
That is the question for today. Is this the brain that we need? What are we doing with the brain that we have?
Most of the time not used.
Dysfunctional.
Dr. Mani should answer.
That's it.
Thank you.
Your answer is that
yes,
it's good first in everything.
I last saw her five years ago. I haven't seen her after that. I presume that with God's grace she is doing well. So these are things that you see. And keep remembering these. Try to do your best whenever you get a patient. Leave the rest to God. Obviously, God has other designs for everybody else. And namm ellarku nariya mola irukku. This much is enough for successful life. Anything else is extra. Thank you.
You said the first slide which you showed, child such a huge hydrocephalus. Can you leave that child without any intervention? Will that produce any pressure symptoms on the other structures of the brain?
It will definitely produce pressure symptoms. It will definitely lead to increasing of head circumference unless the child goes into arrested hydrocephalus, the pathophysiology of which we still are yet to find out in full detail. Therefore, we would be doing a crime by not doing anything or advising not to do anything in a patient who can probably afford something. At least once let us shunt and see.
Dr. Subramanian, there are few basic physiological questions. God has assigned many different functions to different lobes of the brain and many connections. Now, when you get such a expansion, three things are the skull, blood vessel, CSF, and brain. Now, when one expands and another gets shortened, is the shortening or compression proportionate to all the lobes in the brain? Because one can become successful like the auditor only when you have got some function left of all the lobes. If some function is not left of all the lobes, that successful career may not be possible. Therefore, is there a uniform compression when you get a hydrocephalus of all the lobes in the brain?
Sir, in there are two types. The question can be answered in two ways. Number one, in child, the human brain is much more plastic than it is in adult. So in a child, when you compress it beyond belief where even you think that it will not recover, it will still recover. Number two, this is a balloon because the sutures are not fused. So the skull can, head can go on expanding. It's only like a transposition flap which plastic surgeon takes and puts it somewhere, balloon expansion sort of thing. It will keep on growing. There is no end to it. Only thing is the neck will not support the head anymore, so head holding will not be there, settings and sign will be there. Ultimately what will happen is the visual tract will fail by papilledema, post-papilledic optic atrophy and all that. When such a thing will happen will be determined by the pressure inside, whether it's high pressure or low pressure, that we have no way of measuring. Unless we do an LP, we can't do an LP in children unless absolutely indicated. That will not help. So we have to shunt with a high pressure shunt and see if the brain expansion, the skull expansion is becoming, stopping or reducing. Otherwise we change it to a different pressure shunt or put a programmable shunt inside. Now when you say pressure on various areas of the brain, some of the lobes are more sensitive than other lobes. The pressure which is exerted by the hydrocephalus on the frontal bone, frontal lobe, may not be the same as that exhibited on the midbrain or on the cerebellum. It depends. So we can't clearly say this is the pressure. And another point is, this pressure will vary when the child is lying down or sitting up or holding the head down, because then the dampening of the venous channels happens in the neck, so the pressure grows further. So these sort of things are a continuous flow. The last thing is, choroid plexus does not synthesize 12 ml of CSF per hour on a continuous basis. There are times it oversecretes, there are times it undersecretes, there are times it doesn't secrete at all. So we can't say it is a waveform.
And as exactly a certain question I want to ask, you already answered. Is there any method of stopping the production of surplus venom fluid today in scientific name? If so, will that be a method of treatment of ventricular balance?
It was a treatment where we used to go into the ventricle and cauterize the choroid plexus. It is no longer accepted as a form of treatment because program will turn circumventricles.
Okay.